For this webinar on introduction of Big Data and Hadoop and the comparison of MapReduce and PEG. My name is Vishal. I logged in some time back just to check, to do a bit of sound check and just to see whether people are able to hear me or not. So guys, it's sharp 8 p.m. India time, and let's get started. Are we all good? Are you all, or at least the people who have joined us a bit late, or I would say in last few minutes, are you all able to hear me? Could I just get a confirmation from the other guys as well? Thanks, Dheeraj, for confirming. Those Siva and others had confirmed earlier as well. Nice. Cool. Cool then. So guys, let's just get started. My name is Vishal, and yeah, just a bit of thing. It is just that small request to others. If you are not able to hear me for some time, individual, sometimes it happens that, you know, there are some individual problems at one person's end from the internet side. So probably we have seen those cases wherein people would typically like to rejoin. But if this is a problem which is you know, wide across, I'll be looking at the questions tab. If I get more you know, some more people talking about whether they are not able to hear me or something, I'll immediately, you know, do the sound check with all of you. Okay, just in case. Okay, so now guys, let's just get started. So, okay, before even we get started on the webinar, first of all, very warm welcome, guys, and thanks a lot for taking your, you know, precious time to attend this webinar. There are already, you know, such a good amount of people who are already available, and still many more joining us. So, I'll quickly introduce myself. My name is Vishal, and I'm having now almost 15 years plus of experience in industry. Since last 5 years plus, I'm working in the area of big data analytics, and I would say even before that I was completely a data guy, basically worked into Oracle and some other databases altogether. When I talk about that big data and analytics part of it, so big data doesn't equal to, doesn't mean just Hadoop. My journey started with Hadoop, then over the period of time I have moved to some other systems like, you know, there is something called Spark, then there is something called Storm. In fact, Storm we started quite early, and then over to Spark, and then there are some other specialized systems. And now if you talk about my specialization after the accumulation of nearly 15 years in industry, my specialization is in the area of basically implementation of Lambda architectures, implementation of the you know, big data systems with the existing enterprise systems, so their coexistence and integration and that stuff. So that's typical area where I work. When it comes to the exposure of the different domains, so most of my exposure is in the retail domain, and then the next one is the finance domain. So these are the two main domains on which I have worked. There are some couple of projects which I have worked in, you know, in the healthcare domain as well as in the telecom domain. So, and also last but not the least, Hadoop is something which excites me quite a lot. When I say excites me, it's like it's not just the programming stuff, it's the other aspects about its integration with the other systems, as well as when it comes to, you know, educating people about it. Because when we started our journey with Hadoop, there were very, very limited resources available, and webinars like this were at premium. I mean, there was nothing, almost nothing by that time. So that's how, that's I think pretty much about me. Guys who will be joining us for the upcoming batches and others, you know, definitely there'll be the times when you'll be discovering more about me. So let us just get started further. So guys, there are some specific things which we would like to, you know, talk in bit more detail in this session. That would be about, basically in this session I want to focus more about, you know, these are two very kind of common terms or buzzwords nowadays in industry: big data, Hadoop, MapReduce, PEG. So There are quite a lot of webinars which we have done in past, as well as I think even we did something yesterday as well. So big data in Hadoop is something which I'll be covering very quickly here, introduction to big data in Hadoop. But today my focus would be on, let's say, to give you a bit idea about MapReduce. And MapReduce, as I kept on telling to people, and I still tell, that MapReduce is a paradigm. So we will not really focus on any program. We will focus on, as a methodology, what exactly this paradigm does, and what exactly framework does for you, and then how to solve a very simplistic hello world problem. Typically it is called as word count problem of big data world. I mean, hello world problem of big data world is typically the word count problem. So we'll do a quick anatomy of that program, and then we'll quickly see what it takes to write that program and execute it through the native MapReduce code. Of course, the focus is not really going to be the code and API signatures and other stuff. Anybody can understand that it is not really the matter of 1 hour. But the idea is, we'll just quickly have a logical view of our programs. I'll still show you the source code, but again, we'll not really go into the depth of it. But yes, then the immediate next thing will be, we will take the very same problem and we'll try to solve it using something called PIG. PIG Latin. Okay, it's a kind of a wrapper on the top of Hadoop, and then we will see what is the comparative difference, and that is the crux of the matter. That is something which I want to convey as a message out of this webinar, that what exactly are the different components available, and what should drive you towards learning Hadoop, even though you might not be a Java developer. That is what is the kind of message which I want to convey, and if I am able to convey that, that would be the success parameter about it. And then of course there would be some of the areas wherein probably there are some of the most commonly asked kind of questions which I will try to clarify, and then there would be a small section about the offerings of SkillSpeed and how exactly they are different from the others. Again, it would be purely from the perspective of the differentiator, not really a sales kind of a pitch. Okay, so guys, let's just get started with the things, with the business. So are we all good? I hope all of us are, right? Okay, thanks for confirming. So let me just get started with the proceedings. Okay guys, so big data and its challenges. So first of all, what exactly do you call as big data? The simple answer, I'm sure many of you either are already working in this domain, must be starting in this domain, or at least have heard about it, googled about it, right? Somebody or else would have done these things. So there are various definitions, very formal sort of definitions, very I would say unconventional sort of definitions, but let me just get to the crux of the matter here. Whereas big data, as the name itself suggests, it simply means a huge volume of data. Okay, when you talk about huge volume of the data, is this the only thing? So can I say huge volume of data is equal to big data? Probably not really so, because there are various things which come along with it, the challenges which come along with it. So I'll quickly talk about that, and then if we'll see that if all of the characteristics, whatever will come with this huge volume of the data, are satisfying your problem statement, then yes, you are going to deal with a big data kind of a challenge, a big data kind of a problem at your hand. So some years back, your database administrators and all, whenever they used to speak that, hey, you are dealing with the your database file size is, let's say, around some 5 GB, so your database administrators used to typically say, you are dealing with a big data instance, or your database instance is quite big. Whereas, so this was the criteria just some 4 or 5 years back, right, in those typical Oracle MySQL world kind of days. But today, if you talk about it, then this scale has shifted towards the late GBs to the early terabytes. So late GBs in the sense 800 GB, 500 GB, 800 GB sort of data, and up to early terabytes, 10 terabytes, 50 terabytes sort of, right? So if you're really dealing with this, then this is the starting area for your, basically that is the kind of volume which we are kind of, you know, focusing. Of course, for the companies like Google, Facebook, etc., this scale is at way higher. It is like at several petabytes scale plus, right? But even for the middle scale kind of companies, the scale is almost like 8 GBs to the early terabytes. Okay, so that is about the massive volume part. So what is the big deal about it, right? You have told about the volume thing. So what really makes it challenging? There is a kind of a paragraph which is written here, but I'm not really going to read it out, whereas I'm going to actually explain this to you. So now that, good, you are dealing with a huge amount of data, the challenges. So if I ask you, you must be attending this webinar from your respective laptops or your devices or something. So what exactly is the typical capacity or hard disk drive capacity of your laptops? Probably 500 GB, 1 terabyte, 250 GB, etc., etc., right? That would be the kind of capacity which you are having, right? But so this is the typical capacity, right? Talk about some more stronger machines. What will be their normal capacity? You know, probably 5 terabytes, 10 terabytes, not more than that. On a single machine, probably you are not going to have the data more than this, right? That too, I'm talking about the very extreme kind of cases, right? But if you're talking about big data and real, you know, good amount of data, like let's say 50 terabyte or 100 terabyte or I don't know, several terabytes of data, okay, is it really possible for you to store all of that data in a single machine? Definitely not, right? So that simply means at the storage level itself, you have to move from a single machine model to the multi-machine models, right? So your files can no more be stored only and only in one machine. Your data has to be spread across different machines, and now you are talking about the distributed storage concepts. And similarly, the moment you are going for the distributed storage kind of concepts, you have to have a system or file system, I would say, wherein if you say, hey, I want a file 1, then ideally that system should bring that file from whichever machine is having that, you know, physically is having that file. So ideally you should not really be bothered about this particular file 1 is sitting on machine 2. Can I bring that? You should not think about it. The system should think about it, right? But again, it's a challenge, right? Whether it is solved, how is it solved, that's a different question. But I hope you are getting the point. It's the first challenge itself starts at the level of storage. You are no more talking about the central storage, you are talking about the distributed storage. Okay, fine. Now, what is the next kind of challenge which comes along with it? So the very next challenge which comes along with it is, why do you want to store this data? Because you would like to process this. You would like to process this, you would like to get the information out of your data. Am I right? So the simple thing is, if your storage is going to be distributed, can your processing be the central processing? The typical way you write your Java program, the typical way you write your Ruby program or whatever, right? What is the typical model? You provide the data to the program, program consumes it, does some processing, produces some output, probably persists into a database or into a file or just displays in a console or whatever it does, right? But this is a typical model. Will this model work if your data is gonna run, or if your program is gonna run, you know, your data is residing on multiple machines and now you have to run your program? Probably not. Probably you might have to run your program on all of the machines. Should you run sequentially? Should you run in parallel? What about monitoring? What if you are running a program in 10 machines? One machine, the program fails, whereas on the 9 machines, it just succeeds. So should your entire processing stop or should it not stop? Right? All of these are the questions, all of these are the concerns or the challenges which come along with this huge amount of data. Right? So that is what this entire paragraph tells you, that the data volume becomes so huge that it becomes very difficult for you to treat it either from the storage perspective or from the processing perspective or using the traditional systems, right? Guys, I hope you are quite clear what exactly we mean by the big data and what makes it challenging. What makes it challenging as well, right? This is very, very important, because these are the challenges which make this data, you know, this field as very hot and the highest paying field as well, right? Because the way you are going to execute the program, the way you look at the world, the way you look at the problems and the solutions are going to be different from a conventional programmer. That's what, you know, makes this field a bit different. So again, who generates big data? I'm 100% sure there is no prize to guess that Google, Facebook or LinkedIn. Of course, they are the ones which are generating huge amount of data. But are they the only ones which can generate or which generally generate this huge amount of data? Probably not. I was giving this example in yesterday's webinar as well. Let me just reiterate at least for the people who are, you know, let's say new here or who are attending it for the first time. You know, guys, there is this typical jet flight, and a typical jet flight of 30 minutes generates the sensors. You know, there are sensors in the flights, of course, in all those planes and other stuff. They typically generate, okay, they typically generate the 1 terabyte of data for every 30 minutes of flight. Every 30 minutes of flight. Now just think about a flight which is connecting, you know, such flight which is connecting, you know, Delhi to Mumbai, 3 hours, 6 terabytes. Think about a flight which is connecting two ends of the Atlantic. And now you think about all of the flights which are connecting all of this, you know, corners of the world every day. Isn't this mind-boggling amount of data? It is, right? And it is neither being generated by Google or Facebook or LinkedIn or eBay or Amazon. None. Not even from your company, right? So basically, the point is, who generates the big data? Probably, I would say that this big data or this huge amount of data was always available with us. It was always there. It is just that now we are able to capture this data. Okay, so it's not like somebody is generating this data. Data was always flowing. Only thing is, people were considering it as noise. People were considering it as some unnecessary data, and that's it. And then they were just discarding this data. It's only that now these technologies have become enabled. These technologies have emerged, and then they are going to process this amount of data, right? So the big data sources are almost everywhere. I can give a lot of examples in telecom, in retail, even there are some examples like HR companies. You know, your typical those consultant firms and all, there are some dark projects. I mean, this is not really the right time, probably when you'll be there in projects and all, I'll share some of those experiences. You know, there are, you just talk about an area, okay, you will find the sources of big data there. Okay, by the way, Siva says, are you going to repeat yesterday's class? No, Siva. The only thing is that initial part is about the big data and Hadoop introduction. It has to be the same, right? Because everybody has to get the idea of it before moving to MapReduce and Quick part. Okay, so I hope the sources of big data should be quite clear to all of you. With that, I'll just quickly move towards the other part of it. So with this, if we are clear that what exactly is big data and what exactly are the, you know, different challenges which come along with it, what are the different, let's say, how is Hadoop going to help you in this area? So Hadoop, definitely, of course, we are having this webinar about big data, Hadoop, MapReduce and PEG stuff. We are going to talk about that. So of course, I'm definitely going to tell you that Hadoop solves these problems for you. But how? Or does it solve all of the problems, or does it target a specific kind of problems? So let me just tell you guys, I think I need to get to the new screen as well, but yes. Now, look at the slide, and right now don't even think about it. Let me just tell what exactly Hadoop targets for. Okay, so I'm sure most of you people would be aware that there are various kinds of, or there are basically two specific kind of processing which you can do with the data. You can do the real-time processing or you can do the batch processing. What is the example of real-time processing? You go to the ATM, you withdraw your money, and your account balances are updated immediately, right? And you get a message whether you have withdrawn some amount of money or not. That is the typical real-time processing, right? This is the best example of real-time processing. The other thing, batch processing. Let's take the example of bank again. So banks typically do the end of the day processing, right? When they close the shop for the day. So all of the interest accruals, all of the accounting or updating of your general ledger balances and things like that, matching whether your balances are matching or not, till balances, etc. A lot of things happen once in a day. So they typically take the transactions for entire day, process them all at one go, right? That is the example of the batch processing. And Hadoop targets only and only batch processing scenarios of big data. Hadoop targets the batch processing scenarios. Hadoop real-time processing, you can do a bit of real-time processing using Hadoop, but again, that support is limited, and that too using HBase. There are some specialized systems which talk about real-time processing of big data, like there is something called Storm, and then there is something called Spark. There are several others as well which come in that category, but yes, Hadoop's playground is going to be big data batch processing. I hope it should be very, very clear to all of you, right? So before even moving to something, you should know what exactly is the area which it targets, right? So that you can make up your mind, okay, this is the area which, you know, my company or I'm looking for, right? Now, going forward, so everybody knows now that Hadoop basically solves the big data batch processing kind of problems. But what is Hadoop, by the way? What is Hadoop? And believe me, this is the question. If somebody answers this in right words, I typically select that guy for the next round. Okay, if they don't, then after this, my interview doesn't really go quite long. I think within 10 minutes or something, I am going to typically wrap up the interviews as well in that those cases. But I'll tell you a bit about that. So Apache Hadoop, when I ask this question, people give some nice answers saying that it's a database. There are some people who say it's a tool. There are some, you know, even people who say that, okay, it is actually some sort of a language or something. No, guys, nothing. It is actually a framework. Apache Hadoop is a framework. Now, what do you mean by the framework? Are there any examples of framework around us? Yes. Like Struts is a framework. Hibernate is a framework. Ruby on Rails is a framework. Now, what are these frameworks? What do they do? So basically, we typically call a system as a framework or an ecosystem as a framework, wherein it provides you various utilities to do specific things, right? Take the example of Ruby on Rails. It basically allows you to do the web development faster. You just follow some sort of methodology, and then your model, view, controller layer, everything gets created by itself. Similarly, the same is true with Hadoop. Hadoop will provide you different kind of utilities. I think in the very next slide, you will see some of those utilities as well. And we typically call that as Hadoop ecosystem, which will provide you to do various things. Let's say to store the data, there is something called SDFS. To process the data, there is something called MapReduce. Those guys who are not very comfortable with MapReduce, there are wrappers on the top of MapReduce called Pig or Hive. Even for the guys who are going to do some sort of NoSQL stuff with Hadoop, there is HBase. You want to ingest the data, you want to export the data, there are tools like Scoop or Flume. So basically, Apache Hadoop is a framework which allows you to do the distributed processing of, you know, this huge amount of data set on a cluster of machines, on the cluster of commodity machines altogether. Okay, so when I say commodity machines, machines like yours, your laptop, my laptop. Okay, not really the industry standard machine altogether. And then it says using a simple programming model. That simple programming model is nothing but the MapReduce. So you just follow MapReduce programming model, and then the Hadoop takes care of processing your data in a distributed fashion. Okay, and of course it is open source, so all of the source code of Hadoop is available. Okay, now so there are some of the characteristics which are very important. Again, these characteristics are right now at a very high level, but you will be seeing more such examples, or you know, these characteristics make much more sense when you will come to those actual classes, because I typically cover these characteristics after doing a case study of a traditional BI system versus the BI system powered by Hadoop, and then these you know characteristics make much more sense. But right now, just to summarize, so Hadoop is definitely economical. When I say economical, you must have heard about the commodity computers, right? Like your laptop, my laptop, etc. The cost of our laptops is much lesser as compared to, let's say, an IBM server, right? And it is a combination of many such machines, right? So that's being economical is at the heart of you know Hadoop philosophy. Then it is scalable. As I said, it is you know you typically create the clusters. You typically create the clusters of Hadoop, right? So you need more processing power. Keep on adding more and more nodes, okay? More and more machines to your cluster. That way it becomes horizontally scalable. Okay? Hadoop is reliable. So when I say reliable, guys, the chances of your machine going down, the chances of my machine going down are much higher as compared to the chances of, let's say, of an IBM server or a Sun server, you know, going down, and now Oracle server going down, right? So Hadoop assumes that failures are supposed to happen. Failures would happen. And Hadoop takes care. Hadoop has got inbuilt fault tolerance mechanisms wherein it takes care of if, let's say, your program is failing on one machine but succeeding on another machine, so should it relaunch or should it kill? All of those kind of, you know, mechanisms are inbuilt into it. And Hadoop is quite flexible. Flexible in the sense you can process a very structured data, structured like, you know, database table export. You just dump it. You will be able to process. You want to process a free-flowing text? Yes, you can do that. You want to process some of the images? Yes, you can do that. So basically, this framework supports all kind of structures of data, so structured, semi-structured, or unstructured. Every kind of data is supported, right? So that's a brief about Hadoop and its characteristics. And yes, here it is. Here is this entire ecosystem at your display. Most of the things, not most, I think, oh, yes, almost all of the, you know, all of these things are the one which we are going to cover in our course as well. So I'll just give you a very high level overview, because I am quickly moving towards the half of this, you know, webinar, and the remaining half of the webinar I want to spend more on the web, you know, basically MapReduce and PIG comparative study, right? So this is, you can just see HDFS and MapReduce, right? So HDFS is nothing, but it is the storage component, okay? So HDFS is nothing, but it is the storage component of your Hadoop ecosystem, wherein it basically stores the data. It is the storage component. And then you have the MapReduce framework. MapReduce framework is nothing, but it's a programming model for which we'll just see that you just, if you can express your problems in a certain way, then, and you just write some sort of a mapper logic, a bit of reducer logic, and then the framework takes care of running your program into, let's say, several machines at the same time. So all you have to do is focus on the business logic and then leave the nitty-gritties of, you know, running your program on multiple machines on the framework itself. You can ignore YARN and YARN frameworks for now. Basically, it is nothing but earlier versions of Hadoop were basically doing not only the processing part, but the resource management also. In the later versions of Hadoop, you know, YARN has taken the cluster resource management separate. So now MapReduce has just become a framework and nothing else. It's a programming model and nothing else. And then since the cluster resource management is separate, so now if there is any kind of framework or any kind of programming model which supports YARN, it also can integrate with Hadoop. So that is the late change. No need to bother about it right now. you don't really need to bother about it. But yes, the important thing is, can you just see here, it's like Hive and Piglitin. They are the two tools which are sitting on the top of MapReduce. When I say sitting, they basically are the wrappers. And they are the typical tools for the non-Java developers. So typically, you know, there are so many people, I'm sure within this crowd, you know, all of you attendees, right? Many of you would be from the database background, SQL kind of background, or probably some sort of, you know, ETL kind of a background. You are very good with data, but you might not really be very good with the Java kind of a programming. But you want to leverage the power, or at least your company wants to leverage the power of Hadoop. For those kind of people, Hive and Pig are the, you know, wrappers which are built. So those guys who are very good with SQL, they typically write SQL queries. Those guys who are very good with the ETL kind of stuff, they typically write, they would typically, you know, like to write some sort of, you know, Pig data flows altogether. And then the framework itself takes care of converting them to the MapReduce jobs and running them. So you can see that these are the utilities, right? Then there is something called HBase, which is right on the, you know, extreme right here. Basically, this is the guy which accesses the HDFS data directly without MapReduce. And this is the only real-time component of Hadoop. I will stop it right here because there are much more details about HBase, which we can talk sometime later. Then on the top, you can actually see that Apache Uzi as the workflow in, you know, engine. Okay, so workflow engine, it's basically you are now, you might write some of the MapReduce programs, some of the Pig programs or Hive programs, etc. You can just create the workflows or the coordinators, just like, you know, your cron jobs in Linux world. So they, you know, they can just be scheduled. So it basically Apache Uzi is typically used to kind of, you know, productionize your Hadoop jobs. So that's, as now you can see that why am I even calling it as ecosystem, because these are the various utilities which will enable you to do different things. Okay, with that, I quickly try to give you a brief overview of MapReduce as a paradigm. Okay, and then we'll see Pig, how exactly it is different, and then we'll quickly do a bit small hands-on. Just a very small hands-on, not more than 5-7 minutes, okay, just to give you an idea about, you know, whatever I just told you in the slides, you know, when you translate it to real work, what it takes, okay. But anyway, before moving that, I will just give you some of the ideas about it. While I was talking, there were some of the questions. Of course, there are so many people, so I cannot really answer all of the questions right now, but yes, I'm just clubbing some of the very popular kind of questions or the very frequently asked kind of questions. There are some people who says, we do have the other NoSQL databases like MongoDB. Of course, yes, you do have the other databases, but they don't really are, or they don't really fall in the Hadoop ecosystem as such. You can integrate them with Hadoop, but they are not really the part of Hadoop ecosystem. So HBase is the NoSQL database of Hadoop, and of course the kind of storage, and it is basically the clone of Google Bigtable, whereas MongoDB follows a different kind of thing. It's more of a document oriented kind of a database, NoSQL, although NoSQL. Okay, like Priyank and others, I think two, three people have asked this question. Okay, that's pretty much of it, I think. There were some people who were asking this question, is Visual Studio a framework? Part of, I mean, it's not really completely, but yes, partly you can say so. Somebody says, which NoSQL is used by Facebook? Wow, very nice question. So guys, it was using Cassandra earlier, then for some parts it was forced to use HBase. Okay, more on that. This is not really the right time. Wherein, is there a link between Teradata and MapReduce? No, not really. You know, Teradata has an architecture which is almost like Hadoop, but it is not really, you know, equipped with MapReduce jobs. Okay, so now let me just continue and you know, just continue on the other part. So I think, yeah, there is one more good question, and this is the last one which I'm taking, because you know, time, because of the time constraints, I can't take each and every question right now. So somebody says that how is HBase different from HDFS? You seem to suggest both are used for storage. No, definitely no. I think it is asked by Guru Prasad. See, HDFS is the storage. HBase is the database. Okay, just like your Oracle is the database, but your actual storage is the DBA files, right? The same way, HBase is gonna provide you the data models. HBase, whereas HDFS is just going to provide you the file system. One is file system, one is database, right? Clear, right? Thanks, Guru, for asking this question, and I'm sure many people would have thought that way. Okay, let's come to MapReduce paradigm. Okay, quickly about it. So guys, let me give you a simple problem. Again, I'm not asking the solution from you people. If it would have been a class, then we typically follow a discussion style here. But very simple thing. If I give you a list of names, a list of, you know, so many names, and I just want you to tell me how many names are starting with A, how many names are starting with B, how many names are starting with C, and let's say you don't have any distributed programming framework, how will you solve it? How will you typically try to solve it, right? So typical approach is so probably the typical approach is going to be, you are having huge amount of data, probably you would like to split the data into multiple batches, do some sort of threading kind of concept, or probably run them in different machines and then individually just count whatever is the number of words which are starting with every letter, letter, and then just merge all of the results together. Right, this is the very logical approach, and this is how a typical Java programmer thinks, this is how typical most of the other programmers also think that way. But guys, can you just tell what was that operation? That operation was just a group by count and nothing else, right? In the SQL terminology, it is just a group by count. So if I would have asked this question to an SQL guy, he or she would have said that I'm just going to do a group by count and that's it, probably, right? But now, since the data volume is huge, don't you think you are doing a lot? Because you have to think about the logic, how to split the data. If you are going to split it, let's say, alphabetically, so A, B, C, D, and all those names, then probably you have different kind of concerns, right? Or whether are you going to divide the data, just in the equal numbers, right? So these are various concerns, right? And again, the concerns like whether all of the processing has happened, but on some of the machines it failed, so what should I do? How do I collect the data? These are all going to be the different programs which you have to write and then to get the output, right? So just to achieve a group by count, you did a lot of things by yourself, right? Might not really be worth it. So this is where MapReduce framework comes into picture. Whatever I just talked, right, splitting the data, running your logic on different machines, getting the output from all of the machines, just in case if something fails, relaunching it, trying it several times, and then if there is a programmatic error, then telling you, boss, your program is wrong. Otherwise, just try to recover from the failure. All of this is done by the framework itself. And that's what you are actually seeing. So this green area, which is called MapReduce framework, you typically supply the huge amount of input of your data. It automatically splits the data. It has got its own logic, and of course you can also configure it, not really going into those details. And then all you have to do is, you just have to write your mapper logic and the reducer logic. So what goes into mapper, what goes into reducer, probably not, I mean, of course, there is a 6 hours discussion, of course, in the batch which goes into this direction. But at a very high level, you know, typically all of your filtering kind of logic, data transformation kind of logic goes into the mappers, and all of your aggregation kind of a logic wherein you have to, you know, bring all of the data together and do some processing on the collective amount of the data, that is the kind of logic which you write in the reducer. Now, when you say that I am writing these logics, remember, when you write this logic, you don't really care whether your data is going to run on a specific amount of data or on all amount of data, because all of that is taken care by the framework. So what do you write at the end of the day? You are going to write only and only the business logic. And how is it going to run on different machines? None of your concerns. It's none of your concerns at all. That's where the power of, you know, that's where, you know, MapReduce becomes very, very important. That it just just asks you to think in the key and value pairs, and how are those key value pairs are going to be implemented across different machines. That is the headache of framework, not yours. Okay. So with that, I'll just take one example. It's a word count example, guys. I'm sure if some of you people would have already tried on some interviews and other stuff, this must be one of the most frequently asked kind of questions. Only thing is, I'm just trying to tell you how exactly it behaves, how exactly a MapReduce program behaves in the algorithmic way. Okay, so guys, let's say you have this kind of input: Jack, Bill, Joe, Don, Joe, Jack, Don, Bill. For the sake of, you know, illustration, I'll have to take these 9 words, right? Now, whatever you are seeing from this step, from the input, splitting, mapping, shuffling, and reducing, all of this, right, falls in the area of MapReduce. Okay, and all you supply is 2 things. You just supply the input, you just supply the mapper and reducer logic. That's it. And the third thing, of course, where you want to store your output. That's it. These are the only 3 things which you typically supply. So now, I'll just give you the simple logic here. So the first thing is, let's say these records are being splitted in 3. In actual, probably the distribution might be a bit different. Of course, there are some rules for it, which can be covered only in the class. But right now, just to give you an idea about it. So let's say there are some 3 logical steps here, 3 logical separations. Okay. Here it's all about, you are having 3 splits of 1 split per line, right? Now in the mapper, you are just going to write a very simple logic wherein you have to represent your data in the key and value pairs. So what you are going to do is, you are going to take each and every word and then put a hard-coded 1 after it. Okay, it's like telling, I have encountered this word once. So Jack 1, Bill 1, Joe 1. Similarly, Don 1, Joe 1, I think you got the idea, right? So this is the only place where you are writing the logic. You will just be writing only and only the mapper logic, wherein you have got the input. And what is the logic you will write? Assume that I have got the input, I'm going to iterate through all of the elements of my input, and then I'm going to put a hard-coded 1. By the way, this logic is only for the word count. Of course, for the other problems, your logic is going to change. Okay? Then the trick is, here this shuffling part is somewhere the framework kicks in. Framework makes sure that whatever is going to be your key, all of the record for the given key will come together. So here you can see that if Bill is your key, then Bill is there from the first mapper and Bill is there from the third mapper. All of the record will come together. Similarly, Don is there, you know, only from this reducer, so all of the records will go together, right, from both of the mappers. And similarly, the same is true for Jack and Joe as well. So this is the thing which you didn't do. Framework made sure. Only thing is, you have to make sure that you represent your data in the form of key and value pairs. The framework is gonna guarantee you that all of the records for a given key will come together. You don't have to write any logic for it. And then on the reducer side will be the second thing, wherein you will be writing another logic. The logic would be, for a given key, whatever records are going to come, I'm going to iterate all of the records and I'm just going to add them, right? So here on the reducer side, whenever your records will come, you will take bill as the key, and both of the, you know, occurrences, 1 plus 1, that will become 2. Here Don is the key, values are 1, 1, 1, add all of them, it becomes 3. And then the same goes for Jack as well as Joe, right? That is the second place where you wrote the logic. And then again the framework makes sure that even if it is running on 10 different machines, the framework itself is going to bring all of your results together at a single place, wherever you have defined that, okay, this is going to be my output directory, right? That is what I would say is the paradigm. It's just a paradigm. I have not yet told you about the implementation part. I'll just give you a glimpse of it when I'll go to the code part of it. But yes, this is all about the paradigm perspective of it, right? Now, let me just continue. There seems to be some question from Guru Prasad. So guys, and I think Narayan as well. Guys, I'll just touch base on your questions very quickly. Let me just complete this flow and then I'll just try to see, you know, if I can take some of the common questions. So using all of this, you know, the advantages which you typically got is, the first thing is your processing is happening in parallel. So right now you are having only 3 records, right? Of course I'm not really talking about 3 records, I'm talking about several millions of records. So they would be, you know, splitted in different chunks, and each and every chunk is gonna be processed in parallel. And remember, all you did is you just told this is my input, and then how exactly the input splits got created, none of your headache. Then you just thought, okay, this is my mapper logic and this is my reducer logic. How exactly will all of the keys come together? Did you think about it? You didn't. How exactly your reducers, which are running on 10 different machines, you know, whether they are going to put how exactly they are, you know, going to put the result together, did you think about it? You would not be thinking about it, right? So it's all about your parallel processing of the data. And the important thing is here, MapReduce does a different thing. When you run your conventional program, you typically run it in the way wherein you write a program, you supply the data and you get the output, right? That's how you typically write your program. But MapReduce follows a different methodology. It sends the program to the data. So what really happens is, actually whatever input file you would have told, it might be on 10 different machines, right? Or let's say 2 different machines. Your MapReduce program actually goes to those machines and runs there. So here you are not sending the data to the program, you are sending the program to the data. Okay, so this is the huge difference, and we typically call this as the data locality principle in MapReduce. Anyway, more on that whenever, you know, you will get a chance to attend those batches, you'll see that. At this point of time, before moving to the big part of it, I'm not going to explain any code to you guys. I am very much tempted to show you something on my machine. So I'm just flipping it to my virtual machine here. Okay, just a sec. This is my virtual machine. Hold on guys. Let me just log in. Go to the full screen mode. I like it. This is my Eclipse. Okay, this is my Eclipse guys, and you can clearly see that there is a Hello World program. I wanted to show you that you have a mapper program. Okay, you have a mapper program, you have a reducer program, right? And then you have a driver class called WordCon. What is written on it? This is not really the right time, not the right occasion to look at it, but just I'm telling you that this is the kind of logic, and all you do is you just export this as a jar file, and then I'm going to give you a quick demo about how to run it as well. It's a very simple thing. Don't bother yourself with the code right now. What I want really you to focus is, can you look at the number of lines? 60 lines in one class. Another class is having 24 lines. So 60 and 24, 84 lines. Next, is having another this thing 20 lines. So 84 and 20, 104 lines. Let's say 104 or 105 lines, right? So there are around 105 lines for this word count program, right? Guys, did you get the idea? That, right? So you got the idea, right? That I'm talking about, you wrote 105 lines, right? I don't want you to focus on the code. This is, again, this is completely injustice for you as well as to me to explain or, you know, even focus on the code right now. Okay, so this was, just remember in your mind that you looked at around 105 lines of code. Okay, now let me quickly come back to the slide, talk about something, and then show you back in the slide, in the machine, and then run both of the things, and then tell, you know, that's where the wow factor will come. Okay, so that was MapReduce, that's fine, but there is something called PIG. Now PIG is gaining a lot of popularity, guys. It's gaining a lot of popularity because there are a lot of people who now use PIG, and believe me, I myself have not written a MapReduce program since so many months. Okay, it's not that I am not getting the work on it, it is just that I don't feel the need of it. Okay, there are some specific cases when you have to write MapReduce program. I'm not we'll discuss about them, you know, those are the edge cases sometime later, but for all the practical purposes, you, whatever program, whatever code you can write in a, you know, PIG, oh sorry, MapReduce, the same thing can be written in PIG as well. Okay, so what are the different factors which lead us towards PIG? The first thing is Java is not really the preferred language for many data analysts. There are, you know, I was just telling about it, right? ETL guys and all, they are very good with data, but not good with Java. So probably they might not really like to write around 105 lines of Java code just for doing a select group by count, right? For a group by count, why would you write, you know, 105 lines of code? I hope everybody is understanding my point, right? Next thing, you know, just look at this, the second part, which is a funny kind of a picture. 200 lines of Java code is equal to almost 10 lines of PIG code. 10 lines. It's a huge difference in terms of development time, right? Huge difference in the terms of development time. Another thing, many built-in operations. So, you know, having said that, if you have to do a group by operation, if you have to do, let's say, join operation, etc., the kind of code which you have to write in MapReduce is going to be huge in terms of the, you know, Java thing. But when it comes to PIG, all of them are available as the standard operators. You don't really have to do anything other than specifying, saying that, okay, I want to join these two data sets, and done. Whereas in PIG, sorry, in MapReduce, you will end up writing around 400 lines of code for that. So 400 lines versus one word, okay? So there is a huge difference here, right? So probably, you know, you have seen that kind of program, right? So if you are going, definitely if you are going to write lesser lines of code, your maintenance nightmares are not going to be present. If you are going to write a lesser amount of code, your development time is going to be faster. Your Java knowledge becomes optional. I'm not saying with PIG you don't need Java. There are chances when you have to extend PIG. At that time you have to use Java. But again, having said that, for that purpose you can have specialized Java programmers. They don't really need to know, you know, Hadoop. They just need to know a kind, there is something called UDF, so they can just write a UDF and give you a jar which you can use in PIG. So there are teams which work that way. Okay, it's easy to learn, it's quite user friendly as well. And remember, a simple word count, if I just want you to change the logic, it takes a lot of time for you to do the change, right? 105 lines of code, if I just want you to run something within another half an hour, it's going to be nightmare. Whereas with PIG, if you're just talking about 5-6 lines of code, it's much easier, right? This is another comparative study. You're talking about Hadoop, probably you're talking about, you know, around 170 lines of code is equal to around just some 10 lines of PIG code. Development time, of course, is proportional. So again, I'm not spending much time on it. probably if you just want to do a bit of comparison between them, MapReduce is very powerful mechanism for the parallel computation, etc., but it is very rigid. It is very rigid to change. Whereas Pig, it is kind of a high level language on the top of MapReduce. You just write the program, and then how exactly underlying MapReduce jobs are created, none of your worry, none of your concern. So whatever, you know, that big flow diagram I explained to you, probably that doesn't matter to you when you are working with Pig, right? So probably what could be the best use case of Pig? I would say, guys, wherever you can use MapReduce, you can use Pig as well. Remember, just that, you know, there are some of the, it just adds a bit of overhead. When I say overhead, a slight, probably 0.5% slower than MapReduce, but remember, you are working in the batch processing environment. So if my job is running for 35 minutes or it is running for 37 minutes, I don't care. I hope everybody understands that part, right? 35 minutes versus 37 minutes, they are not really very important here. Okay, now I'll do a very quick demonstration of MapReduce versus Pig. Okay, so all of you have seen MapReduce. Just a second, let me just log in. So you just saw at a very high level that there were around 105 lines of Java code. Look at this code. 1, 2, 3, 4. Fifth one, I'm dumping the output. Again, don't look at the code. Just look at the number of lines. 5 lines, fifth line, I'm producing the output. I'll show you by running both of them whether they are producing the same output or not. Saw this? Guys, was it significantly different? Right? 105 versus just 5 lines. Right? Now, only thing which I want you to see is, just relax and look at whether both of them are really producing the same output or not. That's it. Okay? So, let me just go back and let me first run my MapReduce program, which is, just a second, guys. Clear. Okay. So clear. Yarn jar. So basically, I'm just, if you just see this command, it's a yarn. I'm using yarn framework right now. Word count.jar is the jar which I produce. I'm providing it an input and I'm expecting the output in the output directory. But let me just tell you what is my input here, okay, and what exactly is the output, then it would be clear to you so that everybody understands whether the logic also, whether it is working properly or not, right? So I will go back. I will say Hadoop fs hyphen cat. This is the command if you have to look at the content in SDFS. You can see that there are only 6 lines in it. Vishal, 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 Vinay and Vijay. Vinay, Vinay and Vijay. So the output should be Vishal 3 times, Vinay 2 times and Vijay 1 time. Right? So our program is over. Let me just show you the output. So I'll just say Hadoop fs hyphen cat and this directory. I hope everybody understands that the output is as expected. Right, guys? So this was MapReduce in action for you, wherein it just produced the output. But now let me just go back. Now let me just go back, run the same Pig program. Sorry. Run the very same Pig program. And this time I'm just dumping it, dumping that basically sends it to the output on the terminal rather than persisting it. So you can see that it's a bit slower right now because there is a parsing stage and there are other things which go in between. Okay, but nevertheless, it is going to produce almost equally fast output. So you can clearly see this. Right now I'm just putting it in the console. If I would have persisted it, it would have produced exactly the same kind of output. Okay, like no basis, nothing. Yeah. Right, guys. So did you see this? And that's where this is what I wanted to, you know, you guys to take as a carry forward, that it is, there are a lot of things which we'll be covering, but these would be some of the exciting things. I just want you to realize that Hadoop is not just for the Java developers. It is the very much the playground for the ETL guys as well. Okay, so I hope this gives you some sort of clarity. With that, I'll just quickly move to the last part, or I would say the second. We are almost on the time, right? Just top five interview questions. I think I have covered it many times, but I'll just quickly gonna talk about them and probably some one-liners about them. More on that, basically, you know, this is just a pointer, but yes, we'll learn them in too much of the details in actually in the course. There are some people who are saying that is PIG going to create MapReduce jobs internally? Yes, you are right. Internally it will create. Okay, now I'll quickly come to, let's say these are some of the interview questions which you will find anytime, and if somebody does not answer any one of them, I typically don't take that guy. So at least in my team. Okay, so what are the typical things? So what exactly is the use of NameNode in HDFS? So guys, I have not really talked about NameNode here, about the HDFS, but you can just think that NameNode is actually the master system, and then there are several data nodes which are going to be the slave systems. So NameNode is actually the master. It's like anything, whatever you want to access from the HDFS, you have to get it via NameNode. And your data nodes are actually going to have the actual data. Okay, so hence the first two questions, you know, go hand in hand. Then the job tracker. So if you remember, I talked about SDFS as the storage component and the MapReduce as the processing component. So the just like you have the master called name node in the storage side, similarly you have the master at the processing side also, and that is called job tracker. Okay, so job tracker is the one which manages all of the MapReduce jobs whatsoever run in your cluster. What is MapReduce? I'm not answering it. Now all of you know. It's a paradigm of calculation. It's a paradigm. It's a different way of calculating, you know, performing your calculations, and you know, wherein you just represent your problems or your data set in the form of key value pairs and apply the logic also in the very same way. Okay, how does an Hadoop application look like on their basic components? Do I need to tell about it? You just had a look. You just had a look of a simple Hadoop application, Hello World application, and you saw that there are basic three things. You need to have a mapper, you need to have a reducer, and then you need to have a driver class. These are the basic minimum things which should be there in a MapReduce application. So guys, this is just a very one-liner and a very high-level kind of an overview. Just in case if somebody would have attended these kind of interviews, would have been asked these kind of questions, probably it might act as a fact check and nothing else. Expecting that it is delivering a conceptual value to you right now might not really be the best thing to assume. Well, when it comes to the job trends and other stuff, again, I don't really need to tell you about it. You already know much better than me. Talk about any job portal, you'll find those kind of, you know, job trends everywhere. Probably, I'll give you a very quick, you know, idea about the course curriculum. So, we have divided this entire course in 5 weeks. Every week, Saturday, Sunday, two classes happen. And every day we have one module which is covered. So in the first week we typically talk about the big data and Hadoop introduction, whatever I just gave you at the start, in bit more elaborated fashion, quite a lot of elaborated fashion I would say, and the details of SDFS and some hands-on regarding it. week two typically goes into the introduction of MapReduce and advanced MapReduce concepts. So you can clearly see that 3 plus 3, 6 hours. Actually, we spend almost more than 6 hours actually on MapReduce in the second week. Third week typically talks about the PEG, introduction of it, advanced PEG, and what exactly are the different things which you can do with it. And at the same time, we introduce Hive in the third week. We just introduce it. But week four basically goes into the actual concepts of Hive, advanced part of it, and then HBase introduction. Week five is the one wherein we complete the HBase part, advanced part of it. In fact, tomorrow we are completing one batch on it, which is going to be the last class, and wherein we typically talk about the project setup. So, it's not just the logics or it's not just the concepts which matter. Whatever you have learned, how are you really going to apply them in the production ready mode? That's what differentiates us. And on really on the same lines, let me just skip some of the slides. I'll come back to them. I'll just quickly talk about some of the why part of it. So guys, this course is actually designed by the people like me, there are many people by now, you have heard me, so those people who have industry background, they can easily make out whether a person who is talking, whether he or she has worked on it or not, right? So typically it's designed by people like us who need people in their teams who are production ready. So of course our focus is not on the concept, just on the concepts. Our focus is on the application of the concepts. And then you are going to have the instructor led virtual sessions. Of course, yes, there are many people who might be going for these courses at the start of their career. So of course there would be the placement assistance which will be provided there. And the entire material is not for the limited time. All of the material is going to be available for lifetime to you. And of course, we are definitely going to provide you 24/7 support whenever you are faced with the problems during the duration of the course. Now, having said that, you might still have some doubts that whether you want to make sure that whether these sessions make some sense to you, you would like to evaluate it, and then you might really like to attend the course. So of course we have some sort of a free trial also for the people who first want to try and then want to make their decision. So there is 3+ hours of entire training material, so that is almost 10% of the course is freely available to you. And it is not just the training material, even the assignments and the quizzes are available. The real classroom, you'll be able to attend that. And of course, if you need some sort of personal counseling, of course, those things are also available. Now the question is, how do you activate it? All you have to do is visit skillspeed.com website. Just click on the Big Data and Hadoop course, that link, and get to this page as it is shown on the right hand side. There will be a button for free trial. You can then start your free trial. So you will be enrolled for it. You will get the invitation about the batch and other stuff whenever it is starting, and you will get the first part absolutely free. And then that should give you the idea whether you should go ahead with the course or not, right? So that's pretty much about the offerings. If you have some more queries, of course you can visit skillspeed.com, or even you can even the lines are open. So anytime, just pick up the phone, give a call. Either it might be about the suitability of the course to your profile, it might be even about the fee structure, it might be about the upcoming batches or whatsoever, right? Please don't hesitate in calling us back. And yep, so that pretty much concludes this webinar. Thanks a lot. So how was your experience, guys? I just hope that when you started this webinar, it was at 8 p.m. We are at 8 p.m. India time. In this last 1 hour and 8 minutes, I kind of delivered some value to you. Whether you want to go ahead with the course or not, that's completely your call. A lot of these things. Only thing is, the purpose of this webinar is to deliver some value, to deliver some concepts and the things. That's all. With that, thanks a lot, guys. And yes, if it suits you, interests you, we'll meet in the batch. Bye. Bye for now, guys.